Before making my music video, I did some research regarding genre, creating blog posts on several different genres and their typical inventions. I hoped in doing this I would get an insight into what the different types of musical genre there are and what their music videos look like typically, before I decided whether I wanted to use, develop or challenge their conventions. To explore genre further, I analysed several music videos including Taylor Swift's Blank Space, which is a typical pop music video and conforms almost wholly to its genre. I looked at the micro elements of this video, such as mise-en-scene, sound, camera work and editing, to see how they combine to allow the video to conform to the pop genre. For example, within this video there's a heavy focus on creating a star image surrounding the artist Taylor Swift, something which is often featured in pop music videos. This is established firstly by use of camera work, namely a vast amount of close-up shots which linger on her face, but also via mise-en-scene, which is used to draw attention of the audience toward Taylor as she wears several decadent costumes and eye-catching red lipstick. This use of star image in this video was not something I was able to emulate for my actual music video, as I was unable to get hold of a star or celebrity to feature in my video, Digipack and magazine article. In this sense, the products I have now created are unlike the Blank Space video and franchise which surrounds Taylor Swift, and do not conform to Richard Dyer's star image theory, as they are absent of a real star. Yet I think the absence of a star in my work does not necessarily make it any less relatable to my audience, as I have replaced my star with two main protagonists, a boy and a girl, who are normal and relatable characters, as communicated by their casual clothing, minimal makeup and the everyday settings in which they live. So how does and how doesn't my music video use the conventions of a typical indie music video? Well, firstly, it does adhere to these conventions through use of editing. Like a typical indie music video, much of the editing in my video is in time with the beat of the song, making it more engaging and interesting for the audience. This sort of editing can be seen in many other indie music videos too, and is indeed a convention of the genre. However, many indie music videos do feature elements of CGI or computer-based animation, i.e. the Two Door Cinema Club handshake video. This is an editing convention that I've been unable to adhere to personally, given my lack of skill and also the fact that CGI effects usually cost a great deal of money to create. I tried to use a range of different camera shots and angles in my music video, particularly including close-up shots such as these. I did this deliberately to conform to the indie genre, which, like the pop genre, has a heavy focus on close-up shots. In my camera work, I also deliberately tried not to conform to Laura Mulvey's male gaze theory. Though at times the camera does linger on the girl character, these lingering shots are more practical in constructing the narrative of my video and do not have the purpose to objectify her. It can be argued that my video does conform to this theory in the sense that males, represented by my boy character, do dominate my video. For example, there are many close-up shots of him lip-syncing through camera work. He has more screen time than my female character. However, I would say that there is a reason for him more screen time than the female character, and this is simply because he is involved in both the narrative and performance elements of my video. I've not chosen to feature him as heavily as I have necessarily through choice, but simply because it made the most sense to have a male performing my song, as it is by an all-male band, and it would seem more realistic to have a boy performing it than a girl. Thus, any adherence to this theory can be explained. The costume of my male protagonist is a particularly good example of how my video conforms to the indie genre. The boy character in my music video wears a check shirt, jeans and trainers. This is something which a lot of men in indie music videos wear. For example, check shirts are worn by the protagonist in the concluding video by Catfish and the Bottom. Equally, in videos for songs such as Melody Calling by The Vaccines or Tino Jericho, also by The Vaccines, all of the characters wear jeans and trainers. Furthermore, the settings used in my music video are what might be described as typically indie. The area which I filmed was mostly in London, which is a location featured in several indie music videos, such as the Wolf Alice Burrows video. Although sound is important in music videos, given the fact that my music video is not of a live performance, the sound used in my music video does not particularly conform to the indie genre. In the video there is diegetic sound in the form of the song, which of course is featured in every music video, including those belonging to the indie genre. As well as aiming to make my music video adhere to the conventions of a typical indie music video, I had to decide whether I wanted it to include elements of performance, narrative or both. As I discovered, both performance and narrative based videos had their own conventions for me to either use, develop or challenge. I discovered these conventions by studying two indie performance videos, Luna by Bombay Bicycle Club and Heim, If I Can Change Your Mind. As well as narrative driven videos such as the A2 music video for the song Stuck by Canopy Climbers, which was made by students like me. Based on this research, I decided to create a music video which combined elements of performance and narrative, and thus their conventions. My music video does not fully use the conventions of the popular narrative theory by Tvets and Todorov. It does not strictly follow the sequential order that this theory promotes, and in particular, there is no clear problem within my narrative that I have created that the characters in my video have to resolve. If anything, the only problem that there is within the video is where my girl character loses her diary and the boy character finds it on her behalf. However, the narrative I have developed does begin and end with an equilibrium of sorts. Thus, in this aspect, my narrative almost conforms to this theory, but only to a certain extent. My music video does, however, not conform to Prop's narrative theory. The characters he has specified do not really occur in my music video, and in some ways, I think if they did, this would restrict the nature of these characters within my video. For example, if I had, as Prop suggests, a princess character within the narrative element of my video, this would make my character less developed and potentially restrict the representation of women within my music video, reducing them to damsels in distress and objects of desire. I looked at student videos such as If I Had a Gun by Noel Gallagher's High Flying Birds and Matchbox by The Kooks to get some inspiration of how to make my own video conform to both the codes of a narrative music video and a performance music video, especially on a low budget. However, I'm aware that because I chose to make a video combining both performance and narrative elements, my video does not completely use all of the conventions of both of these genres. For example, my music video both conforms and does not conform to the conventions of a typical performance music video. It's much like the Codaline video for The One, which I studied, as it combines elements of performance and narrative. Like a typical performance video, my music video does feature elements of performance in the form of lip syncing, which is completed by my boy character. In this way, it's similar to The One, which features the artist lip-syncing to his own song. However, it is dissimilar to this video and does not completely conform to the conventions of a performance music video due to the fact that the person lip-syncing in my video is not actually the artist. I chose deliberately to challenge this particular convention of performance music videos and not to have the artist in my song perform in my video, as often, indie music videos do not feature their artists at all. Once I had created my music video, I had to create a digipack to accompany it. To work out how to do this, I looked at some pre-existing digipacks. Seeing as it was my objective to conform to my chosen genre, indie, as much as possible, I looked at the conventions of indie digipacks specifically. Analysing digipacks from The Fold, who are the band that performed the song which I chose to make a music video for. The digipack of this Fold's album, What Went Down, does not feature an image of the artist and thus uses the conventions of indie digipacks, which seldom feature the artist in question. In order to conform to the indie genre, I made my own digipack similar to this one and did not feature the artist of my song on its cover. Equally, as this album does, I have made my digipack link in some way with my own music video. I've done this firstly by using the same characters and costumes used in the video in my digipack. Secondly, the brick wall that's featured in the background of my music video can be seen in my digipack also. I deliberately chose to include the same setting featured in my video in order to link my two products together and also to meet the codes of indie genre as often. Digipacks of indie artists include casual or urban settings which are relatable to their audience, like the one which is featured in my digipack, The Brick Wall. In featuring the brick wall setting in my digipack and my two protagonists, I'm essentially fulfilling the uses and gratifications theory by Bulmer and Katz. As I identified on my blog, one of the main purposes of my video and furthermore my digipack are to be relatable to my target audience. The images used on my digipack fulfill this theory, making my digipack relatable in terms of mise-en-scene. As mentioned, the setting and costume I have used makes my characters easily identifiable with the 13 to 25 year old audience that I have targeted this product at. In the same way that my digipack conforms to Bulmer and Katz's theory, so does my magazine advert, as it also features the brick wall backdrop. It conforms specifically to the indie genre in the way that it features reviews from other music magazines. In my research into magazine adverts, many of those for indie albums featured reviews and star ratings from magazines such as Q and NME. An example of this is the Vaccines magazine advert for the album What Did You Expect from the Vaccines? In order to make sure my own advert conformed to this genre, I decided to include reviews from both Q and NME, like the Vaccines have. My digipack and magazine advert also conform to the indie genre through use of colour too. The digipack is much like many other specifically indie digipacks because it is almost totally in black and white. The same can be said for my magazine advert too, which has a black and white background with only one colour image overlaid onto it. Though it's not a strict convention of the indie genre for magazine adverts and digi packs being black and white, indie artists such as the Kooks, the Arctic Monkeys and the 1975 all have products in these colours. In this sense, my products are like them, and this helps them to conform to the indie genre. Following on from this, my magazine advert, like my digipack, was also deliberately designed to be like an advert which the Foals use to promote their own albums. It is like their products with the use of font and logo, and so in this sense uses the form specifically of a Foals product. However, conformity to this is not whole, as the images that I have used on my advert are not exactly like those used by the Foals in their other digipacks and magazine adverts. Their adverts tend to feature more minimalistic images compared to mine, which are of my actors in my music video. Although I do think using the images I have helped my advert to link to my digipack and music video. So to summarise, I would say that all of the elements I have created, my digipack, music video and magazine advert, work together to achieve one primary aim, and this is to sell a product, my song and the album on which it resides. This is certainly a convention and expectation of real media products, and one which I think I've adhered to by ensuring that all of my products are visually linked and present the artists in a favourable way, and even more so, promote their work. Without successful promotion material, it's almost impossible for an artist to be successful. The importance of promotion is something which can be seen particularly in my blog post, Progression of the Indie Genre, whereby I've explained how promotion, especially the use of digital promotion, can help to make an artist successful. The use of promotion is something which causes success on a wide scale and can be seen in not just the indie genre, and is not just used by the Arctic Monkeys, as this post explains. Another example of this can be seen when comparing pop artists Justin Bieber and Conor Maynard. Bieber's success can be certainly attributed to promotion and advertising, which is often seen on his Twitter page, which is followed by an excess of 64 million people. He is a clear example of the type of star that Richard Dyer talks about, as a heavy focus on him and his good looks is emphasising his album artwork and the digipacks for his existing albums, all of which minus one feature an enlarged image of him on their cover and are also seen in the magazine adverts which promote his work. Compared to Conor Maynard, Bieber's advertising is seamless, and although they are a similar age and make music of a similar genre, the cult of Beliebers, which has been built up by this advertising, makes Justin Bieber much more popular. Though Conor Maynard is still a significant artist, his Twitter page only has around 1.6 million followers, meaning that any advertising he does is not seen by as wide of an audience as Bieber's, and so he is not as successful, having less number one singles and albums. This also explains why I've included some elements of intertextuality by referencing the Foals website on my video, Digipack and Magazine Advert, as this is a big platform which the band use to advertise themselves in real life, and will be where I would plan for the majority of my products to be shown. I would however say that my work probably does not sell the artists and their work in the best way possible, and the promotion of them, or it, that I have created is nowhere near as good or well developed as Justin Bieber's. This is mostly because of funding, as good advertising campaigns cost tens of thousands of pounds, which I do not have. With my budget, I have tried my best to create a professional looking music video, magazine advert and digipack, but inevitably my work is not quite at the same standard as the existing media products which I have studied. Thus, my work does use the forms and conventions of real media products in its primary aim to sell the work of my art, although perhaps not as effectively as I could hope.